Hello guys, so in this video we'll be studying how to make a root locus in Z plane. If you are looking for S plane, then this is not the video for you, and if you have not found any videos on how to find a root locus in Z plane, then this is the video for you guys. Actually there are two methods for finding a root locus. One is a regular method and the other is a controller design. As you can see this block diagram, there are three blocks in this. One is a controller, the other is a zero order hold, and the last is a plant. So the plant, the transfer function for the plant can vary from a question to question. The zero order hold is always fixed, and the controller will depend at which controller is to be used to solve this question. So in the controller design, we have to actually design the controller depending on the various parameters or the variations. And in regular method, we will assume what controller we want to use, and depending on that, we'll design our root locus. So the controller design will be done in the next video, because it has many variations and it cannot be covered in this video. So in this video, we'll only cover the regular method. I'll be explaining how to find a root locus by using a sum. It will be much better to understand how to make a root locus, and the steps will be similar for any of the other question as well, because the question, the variations in the question will be nothing but the change in the transfer function for the plant and the value of time. So in this question, we have a controller, ZOH and plant, and we have been given t is equal to 0.5 seconds. As you can see, there's a sampler over here before controller. So we cannot combine the controller, ZOH and plant, multiply all three and then find the Z transform. We cannot do that over here. So what we can do is multiply ZOH and plant together, then find its Z transform, then separately find the Z transform for the controller and multiply the two terms. In that way, we'll get the entire G of Z. So first, let us find the Z transform for the combination of ZOH and plant. So over here, we have Z of 1 minus e raised to minus ts upon s into 1 upon s plus 1. First, we have taken the Z transform of 1 minus e raised to minus ts as Z minus 1 upon Z, and have taken out. The terms remaining inside are 1 upon s into bracket s plus 1. So let us take a partial fraction, which will be a upon s plus b upon s plus 1. So for this expression, we'll put s equals to 0 and find the value of a, then put s equals to minus 1 and find the value of b. So we get a is 1 and b as minus 1. We'll put these values in the above equation, and thus we'll get 1 upon s minus 1 upon s plus 1. So Z transform for 1 upon s is nothing but Z upon Z minus 1, and the Z transform for 1 upon s plus 1 is nothing but Z upon Z minus e raised to minus at. But the value of a over here is 1, so it is e raised to minus t. We'll open up the brackets. Z minus 1 gets cancelled, ZZ gets cancelled. So the terms that remain is 1 minus Z minus 1 upon Z minus e raised to minus t. We'll take the LCM, and the final term that remains is 1 minus e raised to minus t upon Z minus e raised to minus t. Now we know that the value of t is nothing but 0.5. So let's put t equals to 0.5 in the above expression. So after putting the value of t, we get 0.395 divided by Z minus 0.6065. So this is the Z transform for the combination of ZOH and plant. Now we have got the Z transform for ZOH and plant. So now let us find the Z transform for the controller. Let us assume that the controller over here is of integral type. Okay, we have assumed that the controller is of integral type. So the transfer function for an integral type controller is nothing but K by S in S plane. We need to find that same thing in the Z plane. So Z transform for 1 upon S is nothing but Z upon Z minus 1. We'll multiply the Z transform of controller with the Z transform of the ZOH and plant. Thus, multiplying the two of them, we'll get the entire GZ. So GZ is equal to K into 0.3935Z divided by Z minus 1 into bracket Z minus 0.6065. Now we have found GZ. We know that H of Z is 1 because of unity feedback. Now let us look at the characteristic equation. Now we know that the characteristic equation can be written as 1 plus G of Z H of Z is equal to 0. Okay. Now let G of Z H of Z equals to L of Z. So 1 plus L of Z is equal to 0. We know that H of Z is 1 as I have said earlier. So due to unity feedback, thus the equation is reduced to 1 plus G of Z is equal to 0. Thus, L of z is nothing but equal to g of z over here, which is equal to k into 0.3935 z divided by z minus 1 into bracket z minus 0.6065. From this expression, we get our poles and zeros. So pole over here, the poles are 1 and 0.6065, and the zeros is nothing but a single zero. Now we get two poles and one zero. So 2 minus 1 is equal to 1. Now this thing is really important. 1. We will get one breakaway point which will tend towards minus infinity. One will break over towards minus infinity. This is a really important point which will look in the root locus graph, not right now. Okay? When we look at the root locus graph, at that time you will understand the importance of this line. Now, the breakaway points. Now, let us find out about the breakaway points. For breakaway points, we need to put dk by dz is equal to 0. Okay? So, to put dk by dz equals to 0, we need the value of k. To find the value of k, we'll put 1 plus l of z equals to 0. We'll equate this expression in such a way that you will get the value of k, where k is equal to minus into bracket z minus 1 into bracket z minus 0.6065 divided by 0.3935 z. Now we found the value of k. Let us take the derivative. So I have taken the derivative over here. After getting the derivative, I've got z square minus 0.6065 divided by 0.3935 z square. Now we know that dk by dz is equal to 0. So I've equated this term with equal to 0 and I found the value of z. So z is equal to plus minus 0.7788. Now we get two values over here. One is plus 0.7788 and the other is negative 0.7788. So we get two breakaway points over here. Now let us look at the, before we look at the critical gain, let us look at the root locus. Let's plot the root locus first. Okay. So the root locus over here, I have plotted the poles. One is at 0.6065, the other data is at 1, and we have a 0 at 0. Okay. Now, for the root locus, your root locus will start from the poles and will reach towards one of the breakaway points, that is at 0.7788. Okay. So, the root locus starts from here, it reaches 0.7788. Your root locus starts from here and it reaches 0.7788. Now, this point will rise towards 0.7788 over here. Okay, at the amplitude at 0.7788, and it will go all the way to the negative 0.7788 over here. You can plot it over here somehow. Somewhere over here. Okay, now as you remember, I had said that one will break away towards minus infinity. So from this point, one will break away towards minus infinity over in this direction, the other will break away towards the zero. And similar way over here, I forgot the downside part. Okay, so from here, one root locus has reached at minus 0.7788, the other root locus has reached over here. So from these two, one will break away towards minus infinity and the other will break away towards the zero. Now, actually, my root locus is a bit stretched out, so it's not actually a unit circle. The outside part is a unit circle. Because of that, I'm not able to draw an exact circle over here. So, I have not used a protractor to draw the exact circle with a radius. So, it's a rough diagram, but this is the root locus which is to be plotted. Okay, so that's the root locus. Now, we need to find the value of k for which the system will be stable. Okay. We know that there is a range for k, for the values of k, in which the system will be stable. One of the ranges is that k should be greater than 0. We know that. But what will be the maximum value of k for which the system will be stable, and after that point, the system becomes unstable. So for that, we have mod of L of z is equal to 1. So we'll use L of z over here is equal to 1. Okay. Now, we find the critical gain at z equals to minus 1. So we'll put z is equal to minus 1, equate the expression and find the value of k. So the value of k that we get is 8.165. We get the value of k as 8.165. So the range of k will be from 0 to 8.165. So that's the regular method. There's nothing much in this. the first step for the regular method is to find the Z transform, that is convert from S plane. In short, it's a conversion from S plane to Z plane. You get G of Z. Then using the characteristic expression, you get 1 plus G of Z H of Z equals to 0, from which you get L of Z. Using L of Z, you get your poles and zeros. Then you find the breakaway point using the expression dk by dz equals to 0. So you differentiate this term with respect to k and find your breakaway points. After finding the breakaway points, you will plot the root locus. You will plot the root locus over here by plotting the poles, zeros, breakaway points and the entire root locus. After plotting the root locus, we'll find the critical gain for which the system becomes stable. So we find the value of k. That's it. Thank you guys.